because prior to this we had not been sure whether we were walking towards the river or away from it, and when you are tired and want to go to bed, uncertainties like that worry you. We passed Skip Lake as the clock was striking the 11:45, and then George said thoughtfully,
"You don't happen to remember which of the islands it was, do you?"
"No," I replied, beginning to grow thoughtful too. "I don't. How many are there?"
"Only 4," answered George. "It'll be all right if he's awake."
"And if not?" I queried, but we dismissed that train of thought. We shouted when we came opposite the first island, but there was no response, so we went to the second and tried there, and obtained the same result.
"Oh, I remember now," said George. "It was the third one."
And we ran on hopefully to the third one, and halloed. No answer. The case was becoming serious. It was now past midnight. The hotels at Skip Lake and Henley would be crammed, and we could not go round knocking up cottagers and householders in the middle of the night to know if they let apartments. George suggested walking back to Henley and assaulting a policeman, and so getting a night's lodging in the station house. But then there was the thought, suppose he only hits us back and refuses to lock us up? We could not pass the whole night fighting policemen. Besides, we did not want to overdo the thing and get 6 months. We despairingly tried what seemed in the darkness to be the fourth island, but met with no better success. The rain was coming down fast now, and evidently meant to last. We were wet to the skin, and cold and miserable. We began to wonder whether there were only 4 islands or more, or whether we were near the islands at all, or whether we were anywhere within a mile of where we ought to be, or in the wrong part of the river altogether. Everything looked so strange and different in the darkness. We began to understand the suffering of the babes in the wood. Just when we had given up all hope, yes, I know that is always the time that things do happen in novels and tales, but I can't help it. I resolved, when I began to write this book, that I would be strictly truthful in all things, and so I will be, even if I have to employ hackneyed phrases for the purpose. It was just when we had given up all hope, and I must therefore say so. Just when we had given up all hope, then, I suddenly caught sight, a little way below us, of a strange, weird sort of glimmer flickering through the trees on the opposite bank. For an instant, I thought of ghosts. It was such a shadowy, mysterious light. The next moment, it flashed across me that it was our boat, and I sent up such a yell across the water that made the night seem to shake in its bed. We waited breathless for a minute, and then, oh, divinest music of the darkness, we heard the answering bark of Montmorency. We shouted back, loud enough to wake the 7 sleepers. I never could understand myself why it should take more noise to wake 7 sleepers than 1. And, after what seemed an hour, but was really, I suppose, about 5 minutes, we saw the lighted boat creeping slowly over the blackness, and heard Harris's sleepy voice asking where we were.